Accept challenges. Reject norms. Push boundaries. This is Barrow Neurosurgery Base Camp. Your front seat to the teaching rounds of Michael Lawton and Juan Uribe. Join Barrow residents and renowned guests as they seek to understand the most complex, difficult, intricate cases. This is Inside Access you'll find nowhere else. A journey you'll never forget. Come with us as we climb the trail from base camp to the very pinnacle of neurosurgical excellence.
Sacral tumors are usually rare lesions, but when they come to us, it becomes a real challenge. So for neurosurgeons and spine surgeons in particular, you must better know how to deal with sacral tumors, because when they come, they will really push all your skills and your knowledge to the limit. So in this episode, we're gonna show very interesting sacral lesion, and we will walk you through all the differential diagnoses and then obviously all the surgical options. It's actually a very interesting, and as I mentioned, they're rare, but when they come, you must better be ready. And that's part of what we do for a living, waiting for this big shark that when show up, you actually have to perform and not to compromise our patients' outcomes.
Yeah, it's a 25-year-old healthy young female, progressive back pain, was radiating into her lower extremities, was starting to interfere with her sleep. She had lost a lot of weight unintentionally. No cancer history again. Even though she had this pain, back pain and leg pain, she was neurologically intact, full strength, and had good bladder bowel function as well, so.
Any of the med students wants to tackle this a hard one?
I think the differential here is most likely a, given the age, a primary bone tumor, Ewing sarcoma, or things of that nature, or chordoma.
Been going on for a couple of months. She's noticed symptoms getting worse?
Just a couple months, and no family history of tumors or anything of that nature. I think the first step here, if she's symptomatic, very large, is going to be a biopsy.
This is their biopsy tract.
What do you think, Farber, is this?
Chordoma.
What do you think, Cyrus, is this?
I agree with chordoma.
What about you?
I mean, chordoma, I think giant cell tumor, like you talked about, very similar.
What was the biopsy?
Also schwannoma.
That's why you need to biopsy this thing. This one was more complicated surgery, yeah? So it's extending all the way down to S1, yeah? Most of the sacrum is involved, you know? So what is the difference, just for you, Farber, in this one, what kind of surgery will you offer if it's a chordoma?
If it's a chordoma, you need essentially an in-block resection.
Okay, and if it's a schwannoma?
If it's a schwannoma, usually is benign.
My name is Harrison Farber, and I'm a PGY5 at the Barrow Neurological Institute. I wanted to become a neurosurgeon because it's an absolutely incredible field. There's really nothing else in medicine like it, where you have the ability to benefit and impact patients in such a meaningful way. I think everybody, when they go into medical school early in their career, has a fork in the road where they decide if they want to be a surgeon or a clinician. And for me and for many of us, that distinction is pretty clear early on. And in the surgical specialties, there really aren't any fields that compare in terms of the complexity of the cases that we get to do, the spectrum of diseases we treat, and the ability to make such a large impact on our patients. What I love about neurosurgery is the ability to make such a large impact on patients, whether it's emergencies in the middle of the night, or patients with new brain tumor diagnoses, or patients with debilitating back pain that have afflicted them for years. You're immediately given the ability to help them through the skills you learn in this field and really benefit them. I'm particularly interested in the field of spine surgery. I love the complexity of the cases, the diversity of the cases, everything ranging from emergencies to tumors to deformity to degenerative diseases. It's just such a varied and interesting field. Patients come to you with really severe and debilitating problems. You're able to work with them, diagnose their issues, and you have the ability to fix their problems, and you see these really meaningful impacts you have getting patients back to work, getting them feeling better, getting their function back, and it's really a rewarding area of neurosurgery and something I've grown very fond of. I've also had a lot of mentors here who have been able to advance the field on a national scale, and so I hope to contribute to that advancement, kind of pushing our specialty forward as well. We also have a wonderful peer group through our residency program here. We have 28 residents at the BNI, and so we all get along very well. We do a lot outside the hospital, you know, playing pickup sports or hiking together, going on little day trips. We enjoy everything Arizona has to offer. It's definitely a great place to live to blow off some steam when you're outside of the hospital.
Resect as much as you can. So it's great for the patient, but no matter what, it's a big surgery, you know. So this one is a very interesting surgical challenge. The problem is this has to be managed by a senior resident, you know what I mean? And these are very, you know, rare lesions, you know. We see one or two per year. They're very challenging surgeries. You know, this is not the surgery that are performed in a small community hospitals or a small hospital. This has to be in a large, you know, academic centers with a lot of resources, because you need a lot of teams involved to make it happen, you know. On a clinic, you want to get the whole runabout.
Yeah, so as Dr. Uribe was alluding to, this required coordination with four different teams: neurosurgery, plastics, as usual, and then in this case, colorectal and OBGYN. This lady coincidentally also had a lot of issues with uterine fibroids. And so in pre-op counseling and discussion with OBGYN, they decided to go ahead and just actually proceed with a hysterectomy as part of the this case, in addition to resecting the tumor, just for treatment of her fibroids as well. So one other consideration in this lady is they actually took her for pre-op higher embolization, just given how large this was. So they were able to do a little bit of embolization preoperatively. So another you know, collaboration there. You know, in contrast to the prior case, you know, this required an anterior approach, really staged over a couple of days. So as mentioned before, total abdominal hysterectomy, esophagectomy, and then bring in general surgery to mobilize the rectum and create a rectus flap, so, you know, a ram flap basically. And then proceeded at that point, you know, with an L5-S1 discectomy, and really you're at that point working, someone mentioned, you know, before, this is quite different from the other case as well, because it's getting up into S1, even the F5-S1 disc space. So discectomy at L5-S1, sacral osteotomies, and then basically from a ventral approach to resect this tumor. And you're not, that first day, the goal was not for gross total resection, of course, but really subtotal resection, and then coming back the next day. And then I think there's a nice picture here. This is immediately post-op. The patient was actually extubated after the first day, and then come back later. And then but you can actually see this is the ram flap coming back here from the rectus abdominis into that area. And I think they tagged it for the next day when coming back posteriorly to identify it for the second day. On the second day, as you know, kind of a critical part of these cases where I think the decision was, you know, just in case the permanent pathology changed and this ended up not being a schwannoma and it was something like a chordoma, it's important to resect, actually excise the sacral biopsy tract as well. So that was done. And then proceeding with additional posterior tumor resection. So, you know, total sacrectomy from S1 down to the coccyx. So definitely more significant than the prior case, and, you know, skeletonizing each one of the sacral nerves. And this was a critical point, and one that we discussed quite a bit yesterday at the Seattle Science Foundation, was that basically unilateral neurectomies to be able to, you know, get most of the tumor on that side as it was more arising from the left side, but then preserving the right-sided sacral nerves, I think, made a big difference in this patient. So, and then I guess the question comes up, what do you do once you've done this resection? You know, this is kind of where you are after the first day. And then how do you reconstruct the sacrum? How do you reconstruct the pelvis after that? So this is the fixation. So you see L5 and S1 pedicle screws going down to iliac bolts. And then this is a construct put together with a bunch of different side connectors. to connect everything basically across the SI joint to get iliac fixation at that point. And you can see a nice lateral there as well and how much resection there was involved here. For the total sacrectomy.
You see, go back to the picture. You see the skin of the abdominal flap on there? You see close to the screw, that's the skin from the abdomen and wrap it on that thing, or the muscle, you know, the anterior rectal muscle, that then you pull it all the way through to fill that dead space that is gonna create there because there is no sacrum anymore. And you see the dural sac tied up on the top, you know. We left a little bit. You will see on the CT post-op, there's a little bit of sacrum on there, but not enough to put a screw on it. They put two iliac screws, and then you see that's the skin on the middle is part of the abdominal skin, you know. But she heals very good, yeah. Believe it or not, she, after a couple of months, she recovered the sphincter, and she's back and working. It's crazy. You know, it's just because we were able to leave some of the unilateral low sacral nerves intact. Somehow it started working again. A few months, 8 months after, you see it's functioning very good, you know. No foot drop, no nothing, no sphincters. And you go to the next one, you see this is the construct after 8 months, you know. Good balance, it's, you know, solid there. And you see still, you see that the onyx on there. So the onyx is actually, they did a really good job on the endovascular guys, because what you want to do is not to embolize the tumor, it's embolize the feeders of the tumor. So that's what they did, you know. I would say the signature of a good embolization is you take the tumor and you still see the glue, because they just get the feeders, you know, proximal to the tumor. Happy cases, you know, obviously they're challenging, they're very rare, but somewhere in your career, you're gonna find one of these, you know? The trick is, if you're not in a big practice, you're more welcome to send it to us, we take care of that. But if your goal is to be tackling these lesions, they're actually very rewarding when you know what you're doing and you do it right, because you can actually help the patients.